Welcome, everyone, to the Gender and Health Systems Financing webinar. My name is Rosemary Morgan, and I am a research fellow at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health here in Baltimore. This webinar is being hosted by RINGS, that stands for Research in Gender and Ethics, Building Stronger Health Systems. Funded by the UK Department for International Development, RINGS brings together three health systems-focused research project consortia, Future Health Systems, Rebuild and Resist, in a partnership to galvanize gender and ethics within health systems. Last year, we conducted a needs assessment with members of the three RPCs, and it was through this needs assessment that gender and health systems financing was recognized as an important and under-researched topic, both within and beyond the RPCs. And with increased attention to universal health coverage globally, it has become even more pertinent to consider how gender plays a role in health financing, such as how different health financing schemes affect men and women differently. It is our hope that this webinar will help to spur additional thinking around this topic and begin to establish an important research agenda. During the webinar, we would like to encourage participation and urge you to ask questions at any time using the questions functions on the sidebar of your screen. Just type in the question and hit send. Then at the end of the webinar, a selection of questions will be read out and addressed by the panelists. Due to the number of people attending the webinar, we are unfortunately unable to have participants use their microphones during the question and answer session. During the webinar, we would also like to encourage you to actively tweet using the hashtags UHC and gender. I'd now like to just quickly introduce our panelists here today. We have Rob Yates from Chatham House in the United Kingdom, who will be giving a general introduction to health financing and UHC. We will then have Sophie Witter from Queen Margaret University in the United Kingdom, who will be talking about gender questions related to health financing and gaps in the health literature. Veloshnee Govender from the University of Cape Town in South Africa will then look at the gender and health implications of health financing reforms. And then Sundari Ravindran from the Institute for Medical Sciences and Technology in India will give us a case study looking at the lessons on health sector reforms and gender from India and lessons for universal health coverage. Sarah Ssali from Makerere University in Uganda will then be providing a general commentary on the four preceding panelists. So I'd now like to turn it over to Rob Yates, who will be giving us the introduction to health financing and universal health coverage.
Super. Thank you very much indeed, Rosemary, and greetings from London, everyone. I'd like to start the webinar really sort of discussing a very macro issue, and it really doesn't get any more macro than universal health coverage. And first of all, I want to define what we mean by universal health coverage. Next slide, please, Rosemary. So, universal health coverage. A simple definition of universal health coverage is that all people receive the quality health services they need without suffering financial hardship. So you can see there's quite a lot, actually, in this definition. First of all people, everyone, should be included. Secondly, this issue of people being covered by quality health services. And really that these services are allocated according to people's needs. The third major sort of part of it is that people shouldn't suffer financial hardship when accessing these services. So we're very interested in this issue of financial protection from the costs of healthcare. Next, please. So, unpacking this definition a bit further, what we really see is universal health coverage is really all about equity for these reasons. Firstly, as I mentioned, universal means everybody, everyone on the planet. No one should be left behind. Secondly, this idea that health services are allocated according to need, with some people needing more health services than others. In particular, thinking about, say, pregnant women and children and elderly people and people with chronic diseases, they need more health services than other segments of the population. Then there's the issue of the financing contributions, and these being according to one's ability to pay. This meaning that people who have got greater ability to pay, and richer people, pay more than poorer people. Now, if you can combine these two elements, really what universal health coverage is all about is healthy, wealthy people cross-subsidizing the costs of healthcare for sick and poor people. Now, it's very important to emphasize, though, that we're not just talking about curative health services when people are sick. It's the whole range of services, including preventive services, rehabilitative services, and palliative care too. And I think it even goes further than that into issues around the social determinants of health as to why people get sick in the first place, which takes us into areas around education and income inequality and poverty and such like. The other point, of course, to mention is that when we're talking about people being covered by these essential services, they have to be good quality services. There's no point being covered in, say, free health services if the services aren't really adequate. So, next slide, please. Now, here's a very useful way to conceptualize how countries move towards universal health coverage. And this diagram comes from the World Health Report of 2010, produced by WHO. And it says that countries are really trying to fill this box, this universal health coverage box, which has got three dimensions, which really sort of refer to the main policy decisions that countries have to make. So if you look at the horizontal axis, there's this issue of who is covered, which parts of the population are covered. Then there's the dimension of, well, what services are people covered by? So is it primary care services, hospital services? What's in the benefit package? And then finally, the vertical dimension is this economic one on financial protection. So how much are we protecting people from the costs of these services? And basically, every country in the world is trying to fill this box, making these trade-offs across these different dimensions. Next, please, Rosemary. And this definition and this box really sort of throws up some very big issues around the financing of health services and how you should reach universal health coverage, adopting different financing policies. Now, this is an area that's been very controversial over the last 30 years or so, but now I think there is a very, very strong consensus forming around how one can reach universal health coverage. And these are sort of the main findings of this consensus. Firstly, that a market-driven, privately financed health system will never reach universal health coverage. And by privately financed, I mean really individuals choosing when and where to purchase health services, and it being an individual transaction. And of course, the developed country that has got the highest share of private financing, the United States, has famously not reached universal health coverage yet. Instead, what you really need is a strong role for the state to force healthy and wealthy people to cross-subsidize the sick and the poor. This will never happen in a free market with people doing this of their own free will, that people, rich and healthy people, need to be made to do these cross-subsidizations. And of course, forcing people to do this is inherently political. And this is a theme that I'm going to mention more than once today. These reforms are more political, really, than they are technical. What you need is the state to have a big role in each of the three main functions of a health financing system, in how the revenues are raised for the health system, how they're then put together in a big pool, and then how those pooled resources purchase health services for the population. Now, in saying all this, and you can see there's a very, very big role for the public sector and the state here, what I'm talking about is the financing, not the provision of services. And it's not to say that one can't use public financing to purchase private services to cover the population. Also, the private sector may be actually being involved in some of the administration of these financing systems. Next, please. Now, there are also conclusions here around the different financing mechanisms. How does one raise financial resources to pay for a UHC system? And here, there's a clear consensus emerging that, first of all, user fees, charging people for services when they're sick, is pretty much the worst way to finance a health system because you don't get these cross subsidies. And in fact, the president of the World Bank has recently said that healthcare user fees are unjust and unnecessary. This is a radical change to policy from the World Bank, who 30 years ago were promoting healthcare user fees throughout the developing world. Also, we're finding that private voluntary insurance isn't a good route to universal health coverage either. And here I should emphasize that we also include voluntary community-based health insurance. It may not be for profit, but with it being a voluntary system, you don't get those same cross subsidies taking place. And here the findings are that these private voluntary insurance systems are ineffective, they don't really raise enough money, they're inefficient because they have very high administration costs, and they're inequitable because the poor and vulnerable tend to get left out. Instead, the mechanisms that can finance universal health coverage tend to be public financing mechanisms. And here the big two mechanisms are really tax financing out of general government revenues or compulsory social health insurance, where the state forces people to pay at higher rates who are higher earners. And these are the mechanisms that are the key to universal health coverage. It's also important to emphasize that where countries have a large informal sector, it's actually very difficult to get health insurance contributions from the sector of the population. And so in covering large informal sectors, one really does need general taxation revenues to cover this very important group. Next, please. And here's a slide as well, just to emphasize this point about how bad healthcare user fees are. And this is excellent research from the Poverty Action Lab at MIT, showing that for very important preventive health products, just small charges of 30, 40 cents can dramatically reduce the demand from these services. And obviously, it's people who are mostly price sensitive, the poor, who stop purchasing these services when these charges are imposed. So this is a very important justification for these services being provided free at the point of delivery. Next, please. And so, of course, our webinar today is discussing gender implications of universal health coverage and health financing. And subsequent presenters are going to go into this in a lot more detail than I am. But I'd just like to flag up some key points for you now to consider. Firstly, that in looking at which groups should be receiving these cross subsidies, we have to take into account that women are a very high need population group. And often they have low access to financial resources within the household, and therefore they have a low ability to pay. So being a high need group with a low ability to pay, clearly they are a group that is likely to be receiving these cross subsidies. Also, in looking at the efficiency of a health system and maximizing the health benefits of the health system, many of the services that are targeted at women are extremely cost effective around maternal health care, family planning services, and really should therefore be a top priority for a benefit package providing universal coverage. And so in moving towards universal health coverage, what you're finding now is that many people are sort of calling for women and children and other important groups to be at the front of the queue for once in receiving coverage. And this is a sort of a movement really calling for progressive universalism, meaning that we move towards universal coverage, but in a progressive manner, covering the highest need groups first. And as we'll come to discuss, this is highly relevant for discussions around gender and the consumption of health services and financial protection in the move towards universal health coverage. But of course, as I mentioned, that these processes tend to be highly political, and there may be interest groups who don't want to see the movement being done in such a progressive way. And so to ensure that this happens, we need to recognize that it's going to be a political struggle to make sure the vulnerable groups get covered first. Thank you very much. Now back to Rosemary.
Great, thank you very much, Rob. I'd like to now turn it over to Sophie Witter.
Okay, thank you very much, Rob. Well, a typically political and thought-provoking presentation there. So we're going to hold the questions for the end. And I'm going to just move on to break down a little bit health financing. This is really aimed at people who come from more of a gender background. I have no idea, really, the profile of our participants. But then just looking a little bit at which topics are covered and neglected in the literature. So next, please. Okay, I think we can go straight on. So just following on from really where Rob left off, we've explained the concept of universal health coverage. And really it has these three important goals, which are on the right-hand side of the slide, which Rob has explained to us. And as health financing people, we spend a lot of time trying to work out what are the kind of intermediate objectives, what are the things that need to happen for those goals to be reached. And you can see in the middle of the slide that the way equity and the way resources are distributed, but also efficient use of those resources, because no society has got enough resources to meet all of its health needs. And good governance procedures and transparency are clearly key elements. And so the focus for us is really thinking about the health financing arrangements, particularly about how we raise funding, how we pool it in order to cover the risks, as Rob described, but also what are the kind of services we purchase and who gets the benefits and how are the benefits package designed. And so those are the kind of core questions that health financing people look at, and we'll think about those in relation to gender. Next. So just to break that down a little bit, I thought it was useful just to give some examples of the kind of topics that health financing people spend their days looking at, sad as we are. So obviously we need to think about the kind of structures and the architecture for health financing, how are flows managed, really from the national down to the subnational level. We also spend a lot of time thinking about where money comes from, how people contribute, and what are the kind of trends in resources, and how and do they fit with the health needs. We also have to think about how these revenues are pooled and whether the pools are sustainable and how they're managed. So that's really relating to these issues around health insurance functions. And also how the resource is allocated. So ways in which different areas of the country and also different types of facilities and levels of the health system get funded will matter for the outcomes. Not only what kind of health services are being provided, but also how they're being used. And this is where a lot of the equity topics come in, looking at which population groups are using services, what kind of barriers they face, what we can do about those, and whether the sort of health needs of all of the population groups are being met. And all of these topics obviously link to one another. So how services are purchased, how we pay our providers is one of the key factors that will determine some of these patterns. And similarly, underlying all of this is a set of public financial management arrangements, which can be often can be improved and often are at the core of some of the problems. So how funds flow, how they're budgeted, how they're reported on, how much freedom providers have to use them is another topic that we spend a lot of time on. And then finally, of course, looking at the cost-sharing rules, linking back very strongly to Rob's presentation, how far do people know what they're entitled to and how far can they access it? What do they have to pay to access services and how much of a barrier that forms? And fundamentally, what are the accountability arrangements in the system? So when we start to think about some of those blocks in relation to the gender questions, I've just put some examples in the middle columns of what are the kind of questions that we could ask about these in relation to gender. So we should be very interested in who is paying for services and how those burdens fall, and particularly for different mechanisms, what are the implications for men and women, especially given household arrangements in terms of control of finances and access to cash and so on. And so when we change those, how do they affect men and women differentially? And what do the different patterns of public-private finance mean for meeting these different population group needs? And when you look at the literature in relation to those kinds of questions, they're relatively underexplored, except really on some of the literature on user fees, which has looked at implications for men and women and looked a bit at some of the household dynamics and decision making and power arrangements. But it's a fairly underexplored area apart from that. In terms of risk pooling, how are the different groups protected and covered? And how effectively are men and women protected against health shocks? And this is a question that we tend to typically look at in relation to quintiles. So we usually disaggregate by wealth, but relatively rarely do we have the data or perhaps the focus to look at it on a gender basis. Similarly, for purchasing, there's a whole set of very interesting questions around which programs get funded, whether those reflect different gender needs. As I said, public-private mix, and we'll talk, I mean, that's something which is very big in India for the moment. I don't know whether Sundari might come onto that one a bit. But also, are the services that are provided appropriately gender sensitive? And how do we use our payment systems to incentivize good quality care for men and women? So again, looking at the literature on that, there is some work that's been done on resource allocation to maternal and child health and also for sexual and reproductive health programs. But actually, most of the other topics have not really been examined in any depth in terms of gender implications. Resource allocation, as I said, is a really key area within health financing, has not received much attention in terms of gender analysis. And similarly, when we look at the different packages and the extent to which they reflect needs and they are accessible without stigma and utilization by men and women, there are a number of very important angles there on which the literature is very silent. Similarly, on the governance side, looking at questions of representation in different structures, and also how the regulatory system ensures fairness. It's, to my knowledge, and this is all done on a very quick scoping, so hopefully some of our participants will fill in some of the gaps. There seems to be very little done on that as well. Next slide, please. So just to summarise quickly, the overall evidence is there are a lot of very interesting topics out there which could and should be looked at in more depth. Linking particularly to some extent two separate communities of people working on the gender area and working on health financing haven't had enough of a conversation together, and there are a lot of very underexplored areas, and we hope this seminar will contribute to stimulating a bit more work on some of them. We're moving then on to Sundari, who is going to be discussing health financing in India and what we know about the implications for women's access to healthcare.
Hi everyone. So after having heard about the gender implications of different health financing mechanisms, you're now on to hearing a case study from India. Next, please. So the outline of this presentation goes like this. I'll be first presenting some facts on gender-based inequalities in India that have a bearing on health financing. Go quickly over the major health financing mechanisms in India and then discuss the implications for women's access to healthcare. Next, please. So this first slide here is from the National Family Health Survey, which is an equivalent of demographic and health survey in India, and you will see here that irrespective of age, rural-urban location, education, and wealth, a good portion of them do not have control over how they spend their earnings. This slide reiterates the same thing. The percentage of women in reproductive age group who have money which they can decide how to use. Between 40 and 45% of women, even the best from the highest wealth quintile who are employed for cash and have more than 12 years of education do not have control over the money that they have. Next. Another aspect of gender-based inequalities is women's mobility. And again, you see a very large proportion of women, at least 50% of the women, do not have the freedom to go out alone to a health facility, most importantly, and to a number of other places. Next. In addition, there are a number of other gender barriers directly affecting access to healthcare. So 47% of women reported having one or more problems in accessing healthcare. One was that they were concerned that no female provider would be available and therefore didn't even venture to go to the health facility. They did not want to go alone or were not allowed to go alone. They were concerned about having to take public transport all on their own. They were not used to it. They had difficulty in claiming or getting money from the household for treatment. I just want us to keep these facts in mind when we now switch to looking at what kind of financing mechanisms are operational for health financing in India. Next, please. So I now turn to looking at what are the healthcare financing mechanisms in India. It is probably very well known that India is among the countries which has a predominantly out-of-pocket expenditure by households is the predominant financing mechanism. There is tax-based financing for government health services. There are social protection mechanisms for households below poverty line. One called the Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana or RSBY is a tax-funded scheme which purchases healthcare from public as well as empaneled private healthcare providers. And there's a conditional cash transfer scheme for institutional childbirth for women. There is very low penetration by private for-profit insurance, the figures around 4%, and a small number of community-based health insurance and micro-insurance schemes. There is increasing policy support for healthcare provision by private for-profit sector, where you have to pay out-of-pocket to access services. And the policy climate for private for-profit sector is now very positive, and a number of new policy measures have been taken by the new government, including tax concessions and tax rebates for premiums paid to private insurance. Next, please. So I'm just now going to look at each of these financing mechanisms and discuss the implications for women. First of all, although it is tax-based financing, the tax revenue is principally from indirect taxes that are charged uniformly across all income groups, which are therefore regressive. That is, they deduct a larger proportion of the income of the low-income groups as compared to the high-income groups. India has a low tax base, which means that the tax revenue as a proportion of GDP is very low. And very often, cuts to the health budget is a common means of containing fiscal deficit. The long and short of it, the tax revenue available is regressive and it's a very small amount. In addition, there is very low public investment in the health sector, which is less than 1% of GDP currently. So when you have a public health service tax-funded with all these characteristics, some of the major consequences are that there are very limited service delivery points, and the less developed a region, the less likely they are to be well covered by government health services. Inadequate staffing, very large number of posts unfilled is a very common phenomenon. There is shortage of drugs, non-availability of diagnostic services, or non-functioning diagnostic services which are in disrepair and they're never set right, and a very limited range of services at the primary and secondary care levels, which means that for a number of basic problems, people have to access tertiary care. Now, if you remember the mobility-related issues for women, then you'd see how much of a problem this is for women in particular. Next. Let me turn now to the major social protection scheme, which is the RSBY. It covers only those living below poverty line, but we know that it is not only women from poor households who encounter financial barriers. Studies have indicated that RSBY has increased access to care for low-income women. However, the design of this scheme is not really gender aware. It's quite gender blind. For example, the scheme makes available rupees 30,000 per annum for covering hospitalization for the household. And from each household, only 5 members are enrolled within the scheme. Therefore, RSBY leaves the choice of who is to be covered to household gender dynamics. And it may not be very surprising to know that women are not as likely to be covered if there is a competing problem that a male member of the household has. And it has also been found that girls and elderly women are more likely to be excluded when there are more than 5 members in a household. Overall, data shows that enrollment of women is lower than that of men. Then there are many non-financial barriers arising from gendered inequalities. One, women have reported that they did not know which health facilities, private healthcare facilities, were empaneled, and therefore we had to go from one health facility to another to find out where they could use their smart card that is given as part of the scheme. They also were often told that the services they were seeking were not included as part of the scheme, and they were not well informed enough. And even if they thought it was covered, they did not have the confidence to negotiate or to challenge what the providers told them at the point of service delivery. The famous conditional cash transfer for institutional deliveries. This has indeed increased the proportion of women delivering in institutions, the quality of services notwithstanding, but that's another story. But here again, gender-based vulnerabilities have not been factored into the design of the scheme. There is a condition that women will be covered for only 2 live births. And therefore, women from the most vulnerable sections who have higher fertility are affected most, and there are several studies that show this. The scheme operates differently for so-called low and high-performing states. The high-performing states are low-fertility states, And in these high-performing states, only women from households below poverty line are covered by the conditional cash transfer scheme, and only women above 18 years of age are eligible. Once again, this excludes women who have who are most vulnerable from the most socially excluded and low-income groups. In a study that I was part of, we found that only 25% of women who satisfied the eligibility criteria benefited from the conditional cash transfer scheme of the state government. And caste and landowning status were significantly associated with receiving the benefit. So the higher caste and the landowning groups were more likely to get, even among those below poverty line. And the interesting thing was that a number of women had applied but not received, and because they were told that they had not furnished the requisite papers for benefiting from the scheme. The other the side of government's focus on institutional deliveries is that many government health service delivery points do not provide essential sexual and reproductive health care apart other than delivery care, and this is also came across very clearly from another study in Tamil Nadu, which is one of the states with a better coverage of government health services. Private insurance schemes have a low penetration as it is, and they do not cover routine delivery care or contraceptive services. And the prepayment mechanisms, mainly the community-based health insurance schemes, are too small and find it unviable to cover many routine sexual and reproductive health services that a majority of women will need, because there is not adequate risk pooling or cross-subsidization happening. And increasing privatization of health service provision is affecting women not belonging to the below poverty line category disproportionately. Mainly, they don't find government health services of good quality, and when they use private health care, the out-of-pocket expenditure that they have to pay is very high. And we have a kind of a contradictory situation where needed health care may not be available, but unnecessary health care, like unnecessary hysterectomies, are available, or there seems to be a virtual epidemic of unnecessary hysterectomies, which two things seem to contribute to it. One, that the feeling that once women have been sterilized, their wombs are no longer necessary, so any reproductive tract infection or related health problems like dysfunctional bleeding is best taken care of by removing the problem, the source of the problem. And the other is the profit motive of the private health sector. And together, we find needed care probably not available and unnecessary care available. So where does that leave women? We find, not surprisingly, that untreated morbidity is higher for women as compared to men, especially in the reproductive age group. And smaller scale studies have shown steeper gender differences. In low income settlements in Mumbai, untreated episodes of illness was 17.7% in men and 20.3% in women without probing, but 45.3% with probing. And in another study, among urban slum dwellers in Delhi and Chennai, 27.5% and 8.7% of men stated financial constraints as the main reason for not seeking treatment, and the figures were 46% and 25% respectively for women from the same community. So the gender differences are manifold. Next. Here are some suggestions on what is to be done, or what would our asks be if we want a more gender equitable financing system. One, that tax-based public financing of healthcare services with resources mobilized from progressive taxation of income and wealth and not just general taxation. Firm action by governments to regulate the private sector, especially the cost of services. Attention to coverage of all sections of women when implementing social insurance, micro-insurance, social protection schemes, and so on. An essential service package should definitely go beyond delivery care services and family planning. And social insurance scheme should be large enough to ensure effective risk pooling and cross-subsidizing to include the wide range of sexual reproductive health services and other essential services that women need. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Sundari. A lot to think about there, and I think some strong links also to the points that were being made in the first presentation. So we're going to hand over now to Sarah Ssali from the School of Women and Gender Studies in Makerere, Uganda. Sarah's a colleague on Rebuild, and I hope, Sarah, in as well as bringing in some reflections on the presentations, it would be nice if you could maybe say a little bit about some of the insights from the Rebuild work, which I think tie in with the points that Professor Sundari was just making. So over to you.
Yeah, good morning or good afternoon, depending on wherever you are. I think the previous presenters have actually spoken very well. If we can start from what Rob has actually presented, it's true universal health coverage is really about issues of equity, it's about issues of access, and it could not have been stated any better than Rob said, that it actually touches on all the aspects of health, of economics, and of politics. And I think this should just show us that as we are talking about universal health coverage, we should be reminded that actually the challenges that women face in healthcare emanate from all those angles. The challenges that they face emanate from either exclusion politically, exclusion economically, and then they work their way out into budgets and thereafter manifest as lack of access to healthcare and use. And the going forward, your presentation, I mean Sophie Witter's presentation, has done so well to show us what is covered and what is normally not covered. And it's true we've done a lot of work on user fees, but beyond that, there hasn't been much, as she rightfully shows. And I think for the equity issue to be taken further, to include women as well as other vulnerable groups, I think the case she made for health governance and how to police universal health coverage or health financing governance is really very important. I know in many contexts, in many parts of the world, we had what we were calling health unit management committees. In Uganda, we did try this out and we no longer have them, but it would have been a very good avenue for this to be done. Uganda shares a lot in common with what Sundari has just presented, which actually begin by showing, I mean, she started by really showing us that a lot of the challenges that women face in the healthcare system are really challenges that emanate externally. Who has access to income? Who can be allowed out on their own, etc., etc. And seeing what she presented and the different case studies she presented in India, I was actually reflecting on what we have in Uganda, and especially Northern Uganda. And I kept saying, well, what is there for the women? Because Uganda has a number of challenges. Like Sundari said about India, Uganda also has a very low tax base, a very informalized system, very low levels of employment. So even if you wanted to tax so as to provide universal health coverage, I think it would be a challenge of the state about who to tax. And whereas we would think the state should step in to provide this, there's the challenge of a healthcare system which is largely donor dependent. If you're talking about 56% donor financed, then some 35% by the people, and government only provides around 15%. And yet we are, the issues we are seeing, issues of vulnerable populations such as women, really need the state to come in. You wonder what kind of magic can be done. And this is especially the case if you think about the unique situation of Northern Uganda. Our work, All Rebuild's work in Northern Uganda, has shown that in as much as the state has had good intentions of providing health care to the people who were formerly displaced, and especially to the women, there have been some kind of limitations. First, of course, most of the rolling out of the health centers is being done by donors in partnership with government, but largely the financing is donors. And they have tried to put a lot of emphasis on providing healthcare services for women, but as Sundari explained, in India, it is largely maternal and child health, and it is a lot to do with the delivery and immunization of children. Which brings in the question of what happens to women who are not in the reproductive health bracket. Also, it raises the question of what happens to the women who are in the reproductive health bracket but are not giving birth for one reason or another. Those ones seem to be totally out. But also then what happens to younger females? Because you would imagine that in such a context, younger females 15 years and above are generally covered by the MCH program, but many of them are younger people who would want sexual reproductive health services, but even these are not really provided because of the stigma about women and women's sexuality and what proper unmarried females should be doing and should not be doing. And as long as that continues like that, then you find out that the number of women who are likely to be left out. But also, if we are to just look at the maternal and child health provision, there's a big area of mental health, maternal mental health, which is never looked into, as well as mental health for all the other people. And at the end of the day, you realize that what is being provided is really a balance. People are trying to find out what can be managed economically, what can be managed politically, how much should we tax, how much shouldn't we tax. But the reality is, as long as those equations are going to exclude the gender angle, you will continue to have a problem. Because as I've said, like in Northern Uganda, you have very many people who were traumatized by the war, who lost their children to the war or to abduction, but these are not covered. And yet we continue maintaining a healthcare system which is largely based on maternal and child health and immunizations. Now, when we come to the actual provision, the facilities that have been rolled out are always suffering from drug stockouts. There are no medicines. If they come, they are medicines for what is classified as essential healthcare. You know, you have these painkillers and these antimalarials and these medicines against pneumonia, which would be well for mothers who have children. But then you also have the issue of distance. Many people cannot afford because of the distance. And it's not because they are necessarily very, very far, but there's no public health transport. There are no cultural taboos about how far women should go. That's not the issue. The issue is that there's just no well-developed infrastructure, and so no public transport. And the private transport that's available ends up being too expensive for the people. And especially for women who were left as widows, because also widowhood came along with the issue of loss of land, loss of property, loss of identity. So the situation you have in Northern Uganda is one, as Rob says, which actually goes beyond the health sector to look at what livelihoods do people have so as to afford. Or even if the state has tried to provide free health care, the workers are not there, the medicines are not there, and the distances just make it affordable for most people to provide. So I think when we are looking at gender issues and the universal health coverage, or gender issues in health in general, as others have said, they are the access issues that we are all aware of. But beyond the access and financing issues, we should also be looking at the social stigmatization and the social cultural issues, as you saw in India, except in Uganda, they have a different type. They're around more about labels, more about identities, more about what proper people should do and what proper people shouldn't do. And then when you come to the post-conflict situation, it presents more challenges. Who should actually be providing the healthcare? It's good that the donors have come in, but how sustainable is what they are providing? Because the experience we are now having is many of the people who provided the post-conflict rehabilitative care are leaving. The assumption is that now, 5 years after the conflict, 10 years after the conflict, the state should be able to take up. And many of these consortiums that were providing healthcare are moving off. But at the end of the day, what is there left for the state for a poor country like Uganda, which is donor dependent? It becomes a very big challenge. So it is good that the debate around universal health coverage is really reminding us about the need for the state to engage so as to protect vulnerable populations and excluded minorities like women and others. But we also have to question what is the ability of the state to provide. And if the state can't provide, then what happens? Because if we don't investigate these issues critically, we shall stop at the level of rhetoric and have very good policies, but at the end of the day end up with not much service being provided. So as the first presenter said, issues of ensuring that gender issues in health are provided for and for health financing to meet women's gender-specific needs, we need to look beyond health and look at the resource envelope. Let's look at the economics and the reorganization of those economics. But of course, that also will bring in the political angle. Who is supposed to gain, who loses out, and we hope that it will not be the women. I think the state needs to still come in, but how they will do that magic with the limited resource envelope they have is a challenge. But this is not to exclude, to exonerate them from focusing on gender, because actually gender issues in health are pertinent, and as Rob presented, they do not have to be very expensive if you look at the preventive measures. And I think if we focus like that, probably there will be much more that women will reap from, other than just leaving it to the private, as has always been the case. Thank you very much.
We'll have a short presentation from Veloshnee, and then we've got some interesting questions which have been sent in, which I'll raise for the panel. So Veloshnee, over to you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks everybody, and apologies for the technological failings earlier. Can we go to the next slide, please? And probably let's skip to the next one, in the interest of time. Okay, thanks. So just to very briefly, just describe what some of the health financing reforms have been in low and middle income countries. We all know that health systems have been going through significant reforms in one or more of their six building blocks, as identified by the WHO. And health financing is recognized as one of those essential building blocks. Also, as we're aware, the objectives of these reforms have been towards improvements in efficiency, in equity, and effectiveness of the health sector. And health financing reforms have been driven by resource constraints in low and middle income countries, often in contexts where governments have been unable to finance through tax revenue and to be able to provide accessible quality health care for all their citizens. At the same time, the global recession has challenged the sustainability of donor funds to alleviate the resource gap. So just to summarize, what have been the main forms of health financing reforms? These have included, as Sundari has and Rob have described, the main forms have included cost recovery mechanisms, which include user fees, and these often have been introduced in contexts where health financing has largely been supported through tax revenue. And this has been especially widespread in the early 1980s in the context of broader macroeconomic reforms and economic structural adjustment programs prescribed by international lending agencies. And then in more recent years, following the UN General Assembly resolution on universal health coverage, there's been an increasing emphasis on reducing the proportion of out-of-pocket payments and increasing the share of prepayment mechanisms of total health expenditure. Next slide, Rosemary, please. So for this presentation, I'll just briefly discuss the evidence for the more widely recommended and applied health financing reforms, which include, firstly, cost recovery mechanisms which fall under out-of-pocket payments, and secondly, prepayments, including social health insurance and community-based health insurance. Next slide, please. Okay, thank you. As Rob and Bolsunji have looked at some of the gender implications of cost recovery, just want to just probably very briefly highlight is that while gender-based inequalities in access to and control over resources clearly underlie women's poorer healthcare access, regressive health financing reforms like cost recovery, which entail no risk pooling and no income cross subsidies, have worked to further disempower women and socialize and socially marginalized men and limit their access to healthcare. Childbirth services, which include both normal deliveries and C-sections, have often been found to be unaffordable and in many instances have involved catastrophic costs across a range of low and middle income countries. In Burundi, for example, women and children have been imprisoned and denied medical care because of the inability to pay hospital fees. And the evidence now shows that in instances where user fees have been removed, healthcare access and healthcare outcomes have improved. A recent review by McKinnon and colleagues have found that the policy decision across 10 sub-Saharan African countries to abolish user fees increased facility-based deliveries and possibly contributed to a reduction in neonatal mortality rates. At the same time, it's important to note that even when financial and geographic barriers have been removed and have improved access to care across socioeconomic groups, quality of care and acceptability challenges can persist. And sexual and reproductive health services, particularly those which are contested, are often the site where quality of care remains a challenge. And this often requires and calls for investments in policies to address often the social barriers beyond the financial ones. Next slide, please. So what are some of the gender implications of mandatory prepayment schemes, for example, social health insurance? Firstly, what is social health insurance? Social health insurance is essentially a mechanism that pools funds from public and private sources and pays for all or part of the beneficiary's health care according to a specified benefit package. Since it requires prepayment, it eliminates or substantially reduces out-of-pocket payments at the point of service delivery, which is all good. But because it's mandatory, social health insurance allows for risk pooling and income cross subsidies. Under social health insurance, because it's based on mandatory payments through a payroll deduction, it's often limited to the formal sector. Therefore, as experience shows, that it's likely to exclude the majority of women who work in the informal sector unless they're covered as dependents of formal sector employees or their contributions are subsidized through government tax revenue. More recent, a study of the gender inequalities within Ghana's national health insurance scheme by Dixon and colleagues found that women with unstable incomes who reported being food insecure and those living with young children were more likely to drop out of the scheme. Men, in contrast, were 50% more likely to drop out of the scheme for non-financial reasons, including being unsatisfied with the services that were provided. In terms of what is covered, typically insurance plans typically will cover those health conditions that are low probability, random events such as accidents or surgery. In contrast, high probability and non-random health events are considered uninsurable, and these typically include reproductive health services. Next slide, please. Turning to some of the gender implications of micro-insurance prepayment schemes, these typically go by the names of community-based health insurance schemes or voluntary health insurance schemes. And these, the intention is to cover or provide coverage for those in the informal sector. And typically, the contributions and access to benefit package are linked to premiums. However, evidence indicates that even when premiums are modest or nominal, the poorest and those with the least access to cash, which include women, are less likely to be able to participate. Therefore, members' contributions or premiums need to be heavily subsidized from governments and donors, which often doesn't happen. In addition, the benefit packages are typically limited and often do not cover a wide range of sexual and reproductive health services and often might not include, for instance, delivery, normal and C-sections, and contraception. A recent study of mutual health organizations, which is microinsurance, in West Africa found that only very few schemes include family planning as part of the benefit package. An inclusion of family planning services in the benefit package was more common in schemes that were initiated and managed by women. And what we typically find is that schemes that do not offer family planning were initiated by men or mixed groups, suggesting gender biases. At the same time, female operatives or women operatives or co-ops such as SEVA, the Self-Employment Women's Association in the Indian state of Gujarat, which operates a large prepayment scheme for close to 25,000 members. The scheme provides limited insurance for inpatient care. However, while poor women benefit from the scheme, many of them incur substantial debt paying for services that are not covered by the fund. Next slide, please. Just like to review the experience of Thailand. Thailand is an example of a lower middle income country which has achieved universal coverage through a combination of public prepayment schemes. These schemes include the social health insurance, which covers private sector employees, the civil servant medical benefit scheme, which covers public sector employees and their dependents, and the universal coverage scheme, which provides coverage for the remaining 75% of the population. And that includes those who are in the informal and the agricultural economy without access to a stable cash income, which typically includes women, the elderly, and children. Social health insurance component of universal coverage is financed from a payroll deduction, and the civil servant and the universal coverage schemes are financed from tax revenue. And there's growing evidence of the potential of the progressive elements of and success of universal coverage in Thailand. The country has achieved financial protection for all citizens, and there's been a substantial reduction in out-of-pocket payments and medical impoverishment. In addition, there are almost no rich-poor gaps in access to maternal and child health and family planning services, and there's almost 100% utilization of prenatal care, and 99% of births have been attended to by a skilled birth attendant. Next slide, and just to summarize, and I think this just reiterates some of the points that were covered earlier, is that some of the lessons from the evidence suggest that improved financial risk protection, improved gender access in universal coverage, the following is required, is that you need to have, there needs to be a strong role of government, and that prepayment schemes are the only, really the only option through a combination of tax and mandatory insurance. It cannot be restricted to formal sector employees, because then it would exclude women and other vulnerable members of society. And the contributions of more vulnerable members of society has to be subsidized by government through tax revenue. And in addition, as Sundari had also pointed out, is that the emphasis should be on coverage of households and not individuals. And this might then address some of the gender biases within households in terms of who gets covered. In addition, schemes need to look at more extensively of the range of services that are covered, and should include a wide range of sexual and reproductive health services, including non-random and routine needs, example, contraception, pregnancy, and delivery. And there should be also more inclusion of pre-existing conditions so that the elderly, middle age, and older women, both men and women with chronic health conditions, can also be covered. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Veloshnee. So I'd like to just pull out some of the very interesting questions which have come into us from the audience during those presentations. I'm just going to sort of farm them rather randomly to different members of the panel. The first question we got was one from Asha George, and she is asking, are those countries with the most universal health coverage also more gender equal? Is there an association? Can we compare GDI with UHC indicators in global data sets? So I'm going to turn that first of all to Rob, and then maybe if anyone else wants to jump in with thoughts on that. It sounds to me like a good idea. I'm not aware that analysis has been done. Rob, what do you think?
Yes, a very, very good question. One that I've actually answered on Twitter already, actually. I think regarding the politics and the political interest groups, I think societies where women have got a stronger role in determining health financing policy are more likely to have policies that are pro-women. And I think we heard that, you know, very clearly in Veloshnee's last sort of presentation around setting up community-based insurance schemes. Thinking on sort of national levels, I think Rwanda is a very good example of a country where, which I think has got the highest proportion of women MPs, and they've got a fantastic universal health coverage system, which is largely publicly financed, with a very high proportion of the services focusing on women and children's needs. So I think it would be fascinating to do some proper research on that, looking at global data sets. But I wouldn't be at all surprised if more equal societies in terms of gender balance are going to have better health financing policies.
Okay, so there's a challenge to researchers. We think yes, but it would be nice to see some actual analysis on that one. So thank you very much, Rob. So I'm going to take the second question which came in, which is addressed to Sundari, which is just to explain a little bit more about the interaction of gender bias and profit seeking. It's a rather open question, just can you explain a bit more, I guess, your point on that?
I made that point in connection with the unnecessary hysterectomies that seem to be taking place in the country. At the same time, as many women also report untreated morbidity in a big way, you know. So the gender bias that I was talking about was the attitude in society that considered women's wombs as unnecessary once women had given birth to the required number of children, and they had also undergone sterilization. Gender bias also comes from the fact that rather than pay, incur continued expenditure on healthcare because of problems like dysfunctional bleeding or recurrent reproductive tract infections, a once and for all solution of removing the uterus is considered better by a better decision, a more financially sensible decision by households. And that's clearly a gender biased decision. And that feeds into a profit making kind of healthcare industry where it not only unnecessary hysterectomies, there are also unnecessary appendectomies and any number of unnecessary surgeries that can be done without actually grievously harming people. So, in a market for healthcare where there is unequal access to information, and a doctor says, I think you have to get that, I think this is a very serious problem, it could become cancer or something. And I the doctor recommends hysterectomy, and the family thinks that's a better solution. So that was the connection.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, we've also got a more open question, which is, are there good examples of health financing in any country which has impacted women positively? And I think we have talked about some examples. Rob just mentioned the example of Rwanda, and Veloshnee mentioned the Thai case study in her presentation. Does anyone want to highlight some other examples of countries where health financing seems to be serving women?
Perhaps if I can jump in, Sophia. Yes, it's Rob here. I think that we've seen recently a number of countries, wanting to remove healthcare user fees and selectively help proportions of the population, actually targeting reducing or eliminating user fees for pregnant women and young children, and very much focusing on maternal and child health services. One can think of examples in Burundi and Sierra Leone, where this has happened. And I think this has been a very positive step forward. And I wrote a little paper about this in the WHO bulletin a few years ago called something like Women and Children First, a sensible first step for universal health coverage. So people might want to look at that there.
Okay, thank you very much, Rob. Well, bearing in mind, I think, the need to look across the whole life cycle, because I think one of the points we are raising is that there has been quite a lot of attention to maternal health, but less to some of the other healthcare needs in women's lives. Okay, so then moving on, we've got a question which is a bit more specific about abortion care, and the question is, how can we include abortion in basic health insurance packages, especially where it's not even legal? I don't know if anyone wants to talk to that. Sarah, do you have any thoughts on that question, that rather difficult question?
Okay, yeah. I wanted to say that I don't see how that's going to be covered, because in many countries, abortion is heavily stigmatized, looked at as a bad thing, and it is actually a crime. So it will go a long way. And that's what I was talking to earlier, that a lot of the inequalities we see, the gender inequalities we see in health, emanate from elsewhere, from the cultures, from the religions and whatever. But it would also be good for people who have worked in the Northern Hemisphere to tell us, because I understand there the rigidities are not that much, but down here, I think it would be very difficult.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much, Sarah. Veloshnee, I mean, did you want to say something there?
Unmute myself. I think the case of Thailand again provides a good case. So despite having a very extensive, comprehensive benefit package, which includes a range of preventive, promotive services, and you know, a fairly exhaustive range of sexual and reproductive health services, the question of abortion or termination of pregnancy remains a thorny one even there. So I think abortion is only allowed under very specific circumstances, which might be questions around instances of rape, or it poses a risk to the life of the woman. So I think it remains one of those more contested services, which often clearly speak to issues around gender that all societies continue to grapple with.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much. Moving on to a slightly different question here. Somebody's asking, have various instruments like pay for performance, results-based financing, or public insurance schemes been evaluated with respect to their impact on women or on gender inequalities? What's the evidence on this? Would anyone like to respond to that very topical question?
Hi. Hi, Sarah here. I think there's been asked to pilot that in Northern Uganda. With this new health program, that's Northern Uganda Health Program. It was piloted for 2 years. Unfortunately, they have wound up, but they were trying to encourage health facilities to deliver as many women to provide the service, and then from the number of people they had served, then they were compensated or reimbursed by the new health program. And of course, when it was on, it worked very well. Now that the program has wound up, I don't know what's going to happen, because it seemed like the incentive for the health facilities to do that was because they were guaranteed of payment from the new health program. Because the communities that were not in it, because new health operated in two areas. One, it did results-based financing, and actually utilization went up. And in another area, it just financed the services as is normally the case, done by government. And there the utilization was not as high as where there was Arabia. But unfortunately, it has been donor-driven, and the partner is winding up, so we don't know what's going to happen.
Okay. Yes, I think the gender aspects have been quite understudied on the results-based financing, to my awareness. Does anybody want to add to that topic? If not, we're going to put a sort of current question, which is around the SDGs. So one of our audience is saying, what are the views of the speakers on the universal health coverage as proposed in the current SDG goals, targets and indicators? To what extent do you think these will be able to address gender concerns? I don't know, Rob, do you want to jump in on that one?
Yes, thank you, Sophie. Yes, I think that it's unfortunate that we haven't got universal health coverage right up there within the overall health SDG. I personally think the current goal is far too wishy-washy and nebulous. and that universal health coverage would be much better to have there because it really holds governments to account. It's very easy to demonstrate, you know, who's in and who's not in universal health coverage, and people across the world understand it. So I think, you know, those of us who are interested in health equity, either you know, looking at individual population groups or just generally, you know, would be really advised to have universal health coverage up there much more prominently, rather than being relegated to, I think, sort of seventh of the ninth sub-goals. And I think, you know, people who are concerned about sort of gender and health and recognizing that the women are being left behind at the moment, it'd be very wise to rally behind universal health coverage as the best way to get those issues addressed.
Okay, thank you very much, Rob. One of our audience is asking about an apparent contradiction between speakers, so let's just have a look at this. They're confused if enrolling the household instead of individual members leads to gender discrimination in Sundari's presentation, but it's recommended in Veloshnee's. Please clarify. Always nice to have a bit of internal contradiction. I don't know, Sundari, do you want to respond on that one?
I do. I noticed that when Veloshnee said it, and I think it's not mutually contradictory. It is the way the amount allocated, the financial coverage being allocated per household, you know. So in we do recommend that the entire household be covered so that individuals are not left out. On the other hand, the financial ceiling, you know, the amount covered has to be large enough to permit, shouldn't have to compete, and only one person can have. So here the problem was that the amount was quite low, and then not everyone in the household, but only five members in the household, were enrolled, although it was household coverage. So both those together can act negatively.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. So we've got a question about, can certain instruments of health financing exacerbate gender inequalities? Veloshnee, do you want to talk to that one?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Can certain instruments of health financing exacerbate gender inequalities?
Yeah, I mean, I think the evidence that we've reviewed today, I mean, looking at clearly out-of-pocket payments and specifically user fees, cost recovery mechanisms as an instrument has shown to exacerbate or worsen health inequalities, but also gender inequalities and gender biases within households. And I think Sundari's presentation looks at questions around, if you look at the household and there's a limit on, for example, the number of household members that can be covered under insurance scheme. Typically, if there is such a limit, in many instances we have seen that typically women will be left out, children might be left out of the schemes, and the health needs of typically what might be considered the breadwinner, which might be the man, but might be the men, might be covered. So instruments instruments can be gender biased or gender blind. And unless they're designed in a way that redresses and specifically takes account of vulnerabilities.
All right, thank you very much. I'm hopping around on these topics here, but we've got a question, a much broader question, around how to address the social determinants of health within the design of health financing systems, which I think is a fairly challenging one to answer. I'm going to put it to Sarah.
Yeah, I'll say it's very challenging indeed, and the best structure to approach it is the way Rob's presented it. To look at all that is required economically, socially, and also to look at it politically. Because many governments have actually tried in the recent past to roll out universal health coverage, including ours. but actually the political consequences for them are likely to be high. And that's why the rhetoric has not really been matched by the practice. But there's just no way out of it, because from our research in northern Uganda, it was quite clear, unless the livelihoods of people are put are improved, they will never be able to even get the transport to reach a well-facilitated health facility. So the economics and the social determinants and health determinants are very interlinked. The nexus between conflict, poverty, health, and gender inequalities in health are very real, and I think we need to think about ways of doing that. In a small space like northern Uganda, the district heads have tried to approach the health, the household in totality, both health-wise and economically. But as I said, this is a community which is recovering. They just don't have the financial muscle to pull it off. But maybe what we can look at are programs like BRAC and Child Fund and some of those community programs which have tried to reach households, so that in as much as they are rolling out microfinance, they're also talking about healthcare and everything. But that is all occurring outside the health facility. But maybe if they improve it from the household level, then people will easily be able to access it at the health facility.
Okay, thank you very much, Sarah. So we're coming into the last 5 minutes of the webinar. So I'm going to take two more questions, and then I think we will do a very short summary, and we'll need to wrap it up there. But there's plenty more. So I'd encourage you to stay in touch with us after the webinar, send in further questions. And the slides will indeed, just to answer some people's questions, will be put on the RINGS website, which is up on the slide. So just a question about monitoring of the, I'm now trying to find the question. The question was, how far has gender been monitored within the universal health coverage frameworks? And I'm going to ask you to speak to that one, please, Rob.
Yes, I must admit, not enough. I think, you know, that there is a lot of work being done at the moment by the World Bank and WHO to come up with indicators looking at progress towards universal health coverage. But I think, you know, it's absolutely essential that, you know, this is done from an equity perspective, looking at in terms of, you know, gender equity, but also socioeconomic equity, and looking at different ethnic groups and such things. So I think it really is important that all of us ensure that as the progress is made towards universal health coverage, that it is done progressively, and that will of course mean measuring gender equity issues as we go along.
Okay, great, thank you very much. I think we might have to wrap up there, but I want to just give the panelists a chance just for a final comment. Any final reflections before we end the session?
Yes, thanks, Sophie. And just in summing up, I feel, well, thank you so much for inviting me to start with, but I think that for me, the movement towards universal health coverage from a health financing perspective really is all around replacing private voluntary financing with compulsory public financing. And from a gender perspective, where women often have poor access to cash, then that is absolutely essential. So anyone interested in gender equality and health should be supporting universal health coverage, but recognizing that we need to go further than that, and we need to get involved in the political decisions as to how the financing is raised, where the taxes are collected from, and also looking at where the money is spent to ensure that women really do get an equitable share of the resources. So, you know, bottom line, it's all political.
Okay, thank you very much, Rob. I said I was going to do two questions. I've just found another one, which comes from a colleague of mine, so I'm going to have to include it. It's a provocative one. A well-functioning UHC system is equitable and so leads automatically to gender-balanced systems. Why do we need a special focus on gender? What about the other determinants of health? Are there any special reasons to focus on gender? Sundari, would you like to respond to that and put your final thoughts wrapped up with it?
A well-functioning universal health coverage system, I think it'll only get there if it pays attention to gender. And why gender? Because we are 50% here, I mean, of the population. And why gender? Again, because despite that, we have to date been totally gender blind, and I gave some examples of schemes that were meant to protect the poor without any specific attention to the fact that women across various income groups don't have access to finances, financial resources, and so on. So we seem to be blind to a very large proportion of the population, and I don't think we'll ever get there unless we pay attention to gender.
Okay, thank you very much. So that wraps the political with the economic very nicely. Final thoughts from your side, Veloshnee?
I think just to pick up a point that Rob made earlier around progressive universalism and how that can be used potentially as how do we operationalize it, you know, as a method or a tool for monitoring gender inequality under universal health coverage will be an important one. And I think we might pick up some of the concerns that Sundari has raised. And the fact of the matter, what we do know is that there is the politics of choice and voice. So it does not necessarily mean that women and those who are marginalized will be automatically covered, and the healthcare needs will be automatically insured under universal healthcare coverage. So I think my question will be around questions around progressive universalism and how that can be operationalized. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We've got a very nice question here, someone saying, very informative webinar on gender and financing. Thanks, Rings. So over now for the final reflection to you, Sarah, please.
Yes, thank you very much. Hi. This is, I mean, for me, having participated in this webinar, it's very interesting. And just briefly on the question of why gender, I think there are all different kinds of inequalities. But I think gender inequalities emit a particular kind of power relations. It's the one kind of inequality you always have to speak for. It doesn't seem to be obvious. It seems to be elusive. And as Sundari said, if you don't pay attention to it, you can lose it with their consequences for women. Otherwise, participating in this webinar has been good for me. And it's very nice that we are looking at universal health coverage and scaling this up from a gender angle, because one, it brings back the state into providing healthcare. All those states that had looked at this as a private market affair are being challenged to look at it back as their role. So they should take back their role and provide for the people, especially the excluded minorities. But also, as your research showed, this is an area we've neglected. Health financing with regard to gender other than user fees is a very largely neglected area, looking at the other four thematic areas that you had. So your scoping review is a challenge to us researchers and academics to look beyond issues of access and use, to look at issues of governance and issues of policing and ensuring that actually the revenue collection and whatever is goes to where it's needed most. And beyond the healthcare, I mean, having looked at what Rob did, what it shows me and what it encourages me is that the reforms that are going to take off from this aspect and their interlinkages with the economics and the socioeconomics are largely likely to provide transformation, not just in the way we provide and access healthcare, but also to have ramifications in the rest of society. And that's what excites me about both research-wise and in the entire governance of some of our societies. So thank you very much, Rings, for this opportunity. I would like to say thank you to all the panelists and to all the attendees. Thanks a lot, everybody.
I think we'll have to wrap it up there. Thanks to all the panelists and very appreciative comments coming in from the audience. We'd encourage you to look on the RIGS site for the slides from this session and also to blog or tweet, as Rosemary said. Rosemary, do you want the last word?
Sure. Just to thank everyone for coming along today, and thank you very much to all the panelists. We have recorded this webinar, so we will put the slides and the recording up in due course. So do keep looking at the website. And there, when you exit the webinar today, there is a short, very short survey that we would very much appreciate if you could take a few minutes of your time to fill in. Great. Thank you, everybody, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Okay, so the final strap line, which is coming from one of the audiences, if it's not gender balanced, it's not yet UHC. So there we go. Thank you very much. Goodbye, and we look forward to the next seminar.